Hello, welcome to the course on Hadoop development offered by Dataraj Academy. My name is Venu and in today's session, we will learn to install Apache Hadoop 1.x. I hope you all will find this session interesting and informative. In this session, we will learn to set up Apache Hadoop on our personal computer. Hadoop runs best on Linux or Unix-based environments. In most of the real-world cases, we find Hadoop deployed on a cluster of Linux or Unix-based machines. But generally, we have some kind of Windows-based operating systems on our personal computers, like Windows 8 or Windows 10. Hence, we will have to resort to server virtualization to set up Linux or Unix-based environment on top of our Windows-based operating system. We will first outline our steps on a high level, and then we will run those steps to set up Hadoop. So, let's get started. We will start with a high-level understanding of Hadoop installation. Let us take our personal computer. It is a physical machine or hardware on which we have an operating system running. Operating system is a kind of system software. It acts as an interface between a user and the physical hardware. In simple words, operating system enables the end users to access the physical hardware. In our case, it is Windows 10. Let us call this as a host operating system. On top of this operating system, we can install any application softwares if we want. For example, we might want text editors like Notepad or WordPad. We can install Microsoft Office. We can install media players like VLC Player to play media files, etc. Just like any of these application softwares, we can install virtualization software applications on the operating system. That would be our first step. For example, we can install VirtualBox software, which is a virtualization software from Oracle. Similarly, we can install VMware Workstation, which is a virtualization software from VMware. VirtualBox and VMware Workstation softwares are examples of Type 2 hypervisors, which runs on top of a host operating system. We have discussed about virtualization at length in the earlier video. It is strongly recommended to go through the video as it provides valuable insights on the concepts of virtualization. You can find the link below in the description of this video. Once we install a virtualization software of our choice, we can create virtual machines. And that would be our second step. In our case, we are going to go with VMware Workstation. Then, we will create a virtual machine using VMware Workstation by allocating a set of system resources. We can create a virtual machine by allocating dedicated system resources in terms of cores, RAM, and hard disk space. For instance, we will allocate 2GB memory, 4 cores, and a 20GB disk space for our virtual machine. Now, we have a virtual machine at our disposal. In simple words, it's like we have a brand new physical machine with a configuration of 2GB RAM, 4 cores processing, and 20GB hard disk. In order to access these resources of a virtual machine, we need to install an operating system of our choice. We can call this as a guest operating system. So, our third step would be to pick and install an operating system of our choice on which we want to run Hadoop. Since we want to run Hadoop on a Linux-based operating system, we will install Ubuntu desktop operating system on our virtual machine. With this, we have prepared our guest environment. And now, there is just one prerequisite before we set up Hadoop on this guest environment. We need to download and install Java in our guest environment. Hadoop is a software or a framework written in Java. It is mostly written in the Java programming language with some native code in C and command line utilities written as shell scripts. So, Hadoop needs Java runtime environment to run. We will then download Apache Hadoop, configure it, and set it up to run in our guest environment. There are different modes in which we can run Hadoop: standalone mode, pseudo distributed mode, and fully distributed mode. We have discussed about each of these operation modes of Hadoop in detail in an earlier session. The link to that session can be found in the description of this video. In our case, we have only one system, which is our personal computer. So, Possibility of running Hadoop in a fully distributed mode is ruled out, as we need more than one machine to do so. We can configure Hadoop to run in a standalone mode and in a pseudo-distributed mode. Standalone mode is a local mode in which none of the Hadoop's distributed components are active. Hence, we will run Hadoop in a pseudo-distributed mode. In this mode, Hadoop is said to be running on a single node cluster. In simple words, all the Hadoop daemons or processors run on the same machine but on separate JVMs, that is Java Virtual Machines. Here, we have a Hadoop cluster but with a single node in it. Finally, we will run few sample commands and MapReduce programs to check the integrity of our installation. Now, let us run each of the aforementioned steps one by one. Let us start by examining our host environment, that is, our host system. This is important as it will help us to download and install application softwares that are suitable for our host system's hardware and operating system. On Windows 10, we can check our system information, including BIOS details, computer model, hardware components details, and other specifications in a number of ways. Let us check our system information using Settings app. To get a basic overview of our system configuration, the Settings app can provide various pieces of information about the hardware and software. To see the basic system information using the Settings app, we need to open Settings, click on System, and click on About. In this Settings page, we can find the exact version of Windows 10 and build number, which increments every time Microsoft releases a cumulative update or feature update. We can also see the system type, exact processor, and memory installed on our system. And another way to view the complete system specifications of our PC is by opening the system information. For that, open the Start menu, search for MS Info 32 or System Information and press Enter. We can see the system summary, which includes information like system model, system type, processor, BIOS information, and last firmware update date and installed memory. We can also create a report with our entire system specifications. We can select the information we want to export. For example, if we select system summary, we will be exporting every piece of information. However, if we only want to export our computer's graphic card's detail, we can simply select display. On clicking on the file, we can export this data. Browse the location to save the file, enter a descriptive name, and click Save to complete the task. Once done, we can find all the details in this file. The report is a text file that we can open with any text viewer or editor. We can also check the system information using command prompt. We can use a command line tool called systeminfo.exe that allows us to get a great deal of information about our system. This tool will even tell us when the operating system was installed. To see our system information using this utility, open the Start menu and do a search for command prompt. Right-click the result and select Run as Administrator. Type the command systeminfo and press Enter. Once we run the command, we will get detailed configuration about the hardware and operating system, including Windows and update information, architecture, BIOS version, memory and network adapter details, and other pieces of information. With this, we know our host name is Home212, the IP address of our system. Our operating system is Microsoft Windows 10 Home. It's a 64-bit system, and available memory is about 12 GB. We now have a lot of necessary information about our host system, like the host name, type of operating system. We know it is a 64-bit operating system. We have a x64-based processor, and so on. Next, we will download and install VMware Workstation on our host operating system. VMware Workstation is a virtualization software from VMware. It is a Type 2 hypervisor which sits on top of the host operating system. That is, Type 2 hypervisor cannot run directly on host's hardware and requires some base operating system. This type of hypervisor depends on host operating system to make hardware calls. Due to this dependence on host operating system to make hardware calls, there is an increased overhead which affects the performance. We can download VMware Workstation from the official website of VMware. In the downloads, we can check out for free product downloads where we will find VMware Workstation Player. On clicking it, we can find the download link to the VMware Workstation Player for Windows 64-bit operating systems. The latest version is 14.1.2 at the time of making this video. Now, let us download it into our system. Once downloading is completed, we can find it in the Downloads folder of our host environment. Now, let us double-click it to start the installation process. Click Next. If possible, go through this End User License Agreement and accept the terms. Click Next. Choose a location where we want to install this. We will do it in a folder in F drive. OK. Check this and click Next. We will uncheck this for product updates on startup, but it is recommended to join the VMware Customer Experience Improvement Program and click Next. Next again, and then install. After this, the installation process begins. After the installation process is completed, we can click Finish and click on Yes to restart the system for the configuration changes made to the VMware player to take effect. Now, we have VMware Workstation set up on our host operating system. We can use this software to create virtual machines. On starting VMware Workstation monitor or interface, we will get an idea of what we can do with it. Like, we can create a new virtual machine, or we can open an already existing virtual machine, etc. We will choose to create a new virtual machine. We need to install an operating system on this virtual machine, which is Ubuntu in our case. And it can be called as a guest operating system. This guest operating system Ubuntu is to be installed on the virtual machine which we want to create using the VMware Workstation software. We can install this guest operating system Ubuntu in several ways, but we choose to do it using an operating system installer disk image file or ISO file. So, let us look for it and download it from the Ubuntu's official website. We can go to Ubuntu's official website and look for downloads. We would like to install Ubuntu Desktop Operating System as the guest operating system on our virtual machine. We can download the latest LTS version of Ubuntu for desktop PCs and laptops. LTS stands for Long Term Support, which means 5 years of free security and maintenance updates guaranteed. We can have a quick look at the Ubuntu release notes. We can also see the recommended system requirements for Ubuntu. Let us download it. Since the browser I am using is Google Chrome, we can find the Ubuntu disk image file in the downloads folder. Let us keep it like that. On coming back to the VMware Workstation interface or the monitor, let us create a new virtual machine. We will select this option and browse to locate the Ubuntu ISO file that we have just downloaded. Select it, click on Open, it gets detected. Once it does, click Next. We can provide a name to our guest system. Let us name it My Ubuntu. We also need to provide a username. Let us give it as LinUser. Password, confirm it, and Next. We will name our virtual machine as My Ubuntu. We will browse and choose a different location to set it up. Click Next. We will stick to the recommended size, which is 20 GB, and click Next. The wizard is ready to create the virtual machine. The virtual machine will be created with the following settings. We can also customize the hardware of our virtual machine. Like, we can increase the RAM to 2 GB. Similarly, we can also increase the number of processor cores and so on. Let's close this and click on Finish. Ubuntu installation process begins. We can choose to download and install VMware Tools for Linux. VMware Tools is a suite of utilities that enhances the performance of the virtual machine's guest operating system and improves management of the virtual machine. Ubuntu Desktop has a very simple and intuitive interface. It is fast, secure, and with thousands of applications to choose from. For everything you want to do, Ubuntu has what you need. All the essential applications like an office suite, browsers, email and media applications come pre-installed. Ubuntu is one of the most secure operating systems around. We have our guest environment ready, and this is the login screen of our Ubuntu. Type in the password and hit enter. We can see our Ubuntu desktop. Now, let us examine our guest environment. We can go to Applications, Settings, and Details to check the details of our guest environment. We can find the device name, memory, processor details, details of the virtualization software, etc. Alternatively, we can check the system information through Terminal. There is a simple Linux command called uname, which reports basic information about a computer's software and hardware. The -a option tells uname to provide the following information: the name of the kernel, which is Linux, the host name, which is myUbuntu, kernel version number and release level, kernel release date, machine hardware name, CPU type, hardware platform, and operating system name. With this, we are done with installing guest operating system on our virtual machine. It is Ubuntu Desk operating system in our case. We have also verified the system information of our guest environment. A significant number of Hadoop production clusters run on Red Hat Enterprise Linux or its freely available sister, CentOS. Ubuntu, SUSE Enterprise Linux, and Debian deployments also exist in production and work perfectly well. Our choice of operating system may be influenced by administration tools, hardware support, or commercial software support. The best choice is usually to minimize the variables and reduce risk by picking the distribution with which we are most comfortable. Since we will be using our personal computer or laptop for exploring Hadoop, we have chosen the most ideal operating system which serves our purpose, which is Ubuntu Desktop. In real-world Hadoop clusters, number of machines or nodes could vary from a couple of tens to thousands of machines. As we have seen, preparing the operating system for Hadoop requires a number of steps, and repeating them on a large number of machines is both time-consuming and error-prone. So, one must be wondering how administrators set up Hadoop on such huge cluster of machines. For this reason, Hadoop administrators use some kind of software configuration management systems. Puppet and Chef are two open source tools that fit the bill. Finding a software configuration management suite that makes sense to us and getting familiar with it will save us hours of tinkering and debugging down the road. Hadoop has few external software package requirements. The most critical piece of software required is Java. Hadoop is a software mostly written in Java. Hence, it needs Java runtime to run, and it is an important prerequisite to install Java. We need at least Java 6 or later versions, because internally, Hadoop uses many of the features introduced with Java 6, such as generics and concurrency utilities. Hence, we need at least Java 6, or any later versions also will do. Hadoop has exposed bugs in every JDK on which it has been tested. To date, the Oracle Hotspot JVM is by far the best performing, most stable implementation available for Hadoop. That being said, the Hotspot VM has proven to be a moving target from patch to patch. Every patch version has to be thoroughly tested to ensure that it works well for production. The Hadoop community keeps a list of tested JVMs where users post their experiences with various JVMs and versions. Version 2.7 and later of Apache Hadoop requires Java 7. It is built and tested on both OpenJDK and Oracle's JDK. Earlier versions, that is Hadoop 2.6 and earlier, support Java 6. Here, we can see a list of tested JDKs that are in use. Let us start by checking if Java has already been installed and configured in our guest system, that is in Ubuntu. We can open the terminal with a shortcut by pressing and holding the keys Ctrl, Alt, and T together in that order. But what we will do is, we will search for terminal in applications and we will add it to our favorites list. On doing that, we can find the terminal application pinned down here for easy access. LinUser is our username or the user account, and MyUbuntu is the host name. Now that we have our terminal, let us check if Java is installed or not. We can do so with the command java-version, which basically is a command to check the version of Java installed in a system. If there is no output, it means Java has not been installed or configured in our system. So let's go ahead and download Java from Oracle's official website. In menu, we can find Java and then click on Java SE. In this page, click on the Java Platform Standard Edition. Click on the Downloads tab. We will find a whole list of download options. The latest is Java 10, but we will download Java Standard Edition 8. We want JDK, which stands for Java Development Kit. After accepting the license agreement, we can choose JDK tar.gz file for a 64-bit Linux machine, as ours is a 64-bit operating system, which we have verified earlier. We can browse and choose a location where we want to save the file, but we will go with the default location. Click on Save and the downloading begins. By default, the file is downloaded into the user's download directory or folder. For instance, we have logged in as LinUser, so we can find the downloaded file in this location. An important point is to be noted here. To run administrative tasks in Linux-based operating systems like Ubuntu, we must have root access. Having a separate root account is common in most Linux distributions, but Ubuntu disables root account by default. This prevents users from making mistakes and keeps the system safe from intruders. And we cannot use switch user command, that is SU command, to switch to the root user, as we would generally do in other Linux distributions. Then, how to run commands that require root access? To run commands that require root access, we need to use sudo before the rest of the command that we want to run. While setting up Ubuntu, we created a user account, LinUser. LinUser is automatically set up as an administrator and therefore automatically added to what is known as the sudoers list. The sudoers list contains the names of all the accounts that are entitled to use the sudo command. The brilliance of sudo is that even if we walk away from our computer without locking it, and if another person tries to access our machine, They can't run admin commands on the computer because even though if they use sudo, they need our password to run that command. Every time we run a command with sudo that require administrator privileges, we will be asked for our password. This is brilliant for security. For example, apt-get is a software package management command line utility tool in Ubuntu. Apt-get is a command line utility tool for retrieval of packages and information about them from authenticated sources, and for installation, upgrade, and removal of packages together with their dependencies. Apt-get operates on a database of known available softwares. It performs installations, package searches, and many other operations by referring to this database. Due to this fact, before beginning any packaging operations with apt-get, we need to ensure that our local copy of the database is up to date. We can update the database with this command. Apt-get requires administrative privileges for most operations. Once we run the command, we will see a list of servers we are retrieving information from. After this, our database should be up to date. We can now upgrade the packages on our system by issuing this command. This command will upgrade all our software packages in the system. And one more important thing, we will use a dedicated Hadoop user account for running Hadoop. While that's not mandatory, it is recommended because it helps to separate the Hadoop installation from other software applications and user accounts running on the same machine. Think about security, permissions, backups, etc. This command will add a new group with the name Hadoop. The group ID allocated is 1001. And this will create a user, HD user, and add it to the group Hadoop in our local machine. We can provide a password we want. We can check out the details of the new user that we created. HD user is the user account and the user ID is 1001. It belongs to the group Hadoop and the group ID of Hadoop is 1001. Similarly, let us check the details of the lin user that we have been using. So the ID is 1000. Now let us switch to the new user that we created. We can see the changes in the command prompt. The present working directory is HD user, whose parent directory is home. The parent directory of home is root. This is also the home directory of the HD user. Now, let us go to the location where we downloaded Java JDK tar gz file, which is the downloads folder in the home directory of lin user. We should be able to see our file. Let us make a note of the file name, or we can select it with the mouse, right click and choose copy. Now we will try to extract the file. We won't be able to do it as the permission is denied. This time we'll try to do the same with sudo. Even this doesn't work because HD user is not in the sudoers file. To resolve this, we will switch back to our lin user account which has sudo rights. And we will add HD user to the sudoers list. Again, we will switch to HD user to perform the extraction of the file. Let us navigate to the directory where we have our JDK tar gz file. Since HD user is in the sudoers list, the command works fine this time. Once completed, we can see an extracted directory in the same location as the original file. We can also check this out using the graphical user interface. We can remove this tar.gz file as we don't need it anymore. But we will do it through the command line interface. The next step is to move the extracted directory to the location where we want to set up Java. To make Java available for all the users of the system, let us move the file to this location. Before that, first let us check if there is already a directory named Java in the said location. If no, then we will create a directory. Now, let us move the extracted directory to the location where we want to set up Java. The file has moved. It is no more in its original location. Now, let us take a moment to understand our Java installation directory hierarchy. In Ubuntu, all files and directories appear under the root directory, represented as slash. Under this root directory, we have a subdirectory called user. Again in user, there is another subdirectory called local. All these have come by default with installation. Under local, we have created a directory called Java. In this Java directory, we have placed our JDK directory, which we have extracted. Now, let us take a quick sneak peek into our JDK directory. JDK stands for Java Development Kit. Inside JDK, there is another directory called bin, which has binaries like Java C, which represents Java compiler. JDK also has a folder called JRE, which contains binaries that represent Java runtime environment. So, bin directory in JDK has many important development related tools. And bin directory in JRE has many important runtime tools. Let us take a variable called Java home and assign it with a value. The value is the absolute path of the JDK. Similarly, let us take another variable called JRE home and assign it with the absolute path of the JRE. And then there is a system level variable called path. The absolute paths of JDK bin and JRE bin directories have to be appended to the value of this path variable as well. In order to store these variables and values permanently across the sessions and across all the users of the system, we need to add them in a file called profile. Let's do that now. We can choose any editor to do that. We will use gedit. Let us add these lines at the bottom of the file and save. There are few more things that we have to do. This is a command to inform our Ubuntu operating system about the location of Oracle's JDK and JRE. And this command notifies the system that the Oracle Java Web Start is available for use. And finally, these commands are used to set our Oracle JDK 8 as the default Java in our Ubuntu. After updating the file profile with Java home, JRE home, and path variables, we need to refresh the file by executing it. With this, we are done setting up Java on our Ubuntu operating system. We can verify our installation with java-version command. So, we have completed installing and configuring Java on our guest operating system, that is Ubuntu. And additionally, we have also created a new user account, HD user, which is what we will be using for all our installation. Next important step is to configure Secure Shell. When setting up a Hadoop cluster in a fully distributed mode, we will need to designate few specific nodes as the master nodes. These master nodes will typically host the master services like name node, job tracker, and secondary name node. These master nodes will serve as base stations, contacting and activating the data node and task tracker daemons on all of the slave nodes. As such, we need to define a means for the master nodes to remotely access every node in our cluster. We have been speaking in general terms of one node accessing another. More precisely, this access is from a user account on one node to another user account on the target machine. For Hadoop, the accounts should have the same username on all of the nodes. Like for example, we created HD user for that purpose. And for security purpose, it is recommended to be a user level account. This account is only for managing our Hadoop cluster. Once the cluster daemons are up and running, we will be able to run our actual MapReduce jobs from other accounts as well. Hadoop uses passphraseless SSH for this purpose. Secure Shell is a cryptographic network protocol for operating network services securely over an unsecured network. The best known example application is for remote login to computer systems by users. SSH provides a secure channel over an unsecured network in a client-server architecture, connecting an SSH client application with an SSH server. Common applications include remote command line login and remote command execution, but any network service can be secured with SSH. SSH utilizes standard public key cryptography to create a pair of keys for user verification, one public, one private. The public key is stored locally on every node in the cluster, and the master node sends the private key when attempting to access a remote machine. With both pieces of information, the target machine can validate the login attempt. But in a pseudo-distributed mode, we have only one machine. All the master daemons and slave daemons run on the same machine. Pseudo-distributed mode is just a special case of fully distributed mode, in which the single host is localhost, that is, our machine. So we need to make sure that we can SSH to localhost and login without having to enter a password. While installing Hadoop on our machine, we have to start Hadoop daemons. To do so, we are provided few Hadoop control scripts. For example, there are scripts for stopping and starting all the Hadoop distributed daemons. And to do that, using the supplied scripts, we need to have SSH installed. SSH setup is required to do these different operations. To work seamlessly, SSH needs to be set up to allow passwordless login for the Hadoop user. The simplest way to achieve this is to generate a public-private key pair. Let us start by verifying our SSH installation. If logged in as any other user, switch to HD user. The first step is to check whether SSH is already installed on our machine. On Ubuntu, for example, this can be achieved with which command. Let us check SSH client. And now let us check for SSH server side daemon. We see no output. The best approach to deal with this is to reinstall OpenSSH server on our system. It is a good practice to purge before start of installation. And now let's reinstall it. Press Y to continue. We can install OpenSSH via a Linux package manager or by downloading directly from the source. For our single node setup of Hadoop, we therefore need to configure SSH access to localhost for the HD user which we created earlier. That is, we have to generate SSH key for the user account HD user. Having verified that SSH is correctly installed on our machine, we can use SSH keygen on the master node to generate RSA key pair. This command will create a new key. It will create RSA key pair with an empty password. Hyphen P and empty double quotes here indicates an empty password. Just press enter to save the key in the default file. And this generates the public-private RSA key pair. The public key is saved in this location. After creating the key pair, the public key will be of this form. And in case of a fully distributed cluster with multiple nodes, we need to distribute this public key across our cluster. Now, we have to enable SSH access to our local machine with this newly created key. This command copies the public keys from id_rsa.pub to authorized keys. The final step is to test the SSH setup by connecting to the local machine with the HD user. This will be asked for the first time, so type yes and press enter. This step is also needed to save our local machine's host key fingerprint to the HD user's known host file. To test that, we can connect again. We can see here, it did not ask for a password. A quick recap of what we have accomplished till now. On our personal computer or laptop, we have installed a virtualization software. We have installed VMware Workstation. Using VMware Workstation, we have created a virtual machine and allocated a set of physical resources to it. Like in our case, we have allotted 20 GB disk space, 2 GB RAM, and 2 cores. In order to utilize the virtual machine, we installed Ubuntu operating system on it, which is the guest operating system. We have chosen Ubuntu, which is a Linux-based operating system, because GNU Linux is the official development and production platform for Hadoop. Although, Windows is also supported. For Windows, we will need to install Cygwin for shell support to enable shell and Unix scripts. Hadoop has few software dependencies, and Java is the most important of them. So, we installed Java in our guest operating system, that is, in Ubuntu. Then, we created a user account, HD user, and added it to the sudoers list. Next, we configured SSH, which is necessary to run Hadoop-related scripts. In the sudo distributed mode or a single node cluster, while all the daemons are running on the same machine, they still communicate with each other using the same SSH protocol as if they were distributed over a cluster. We also verified if our machine allows us to SSH back to itself. Now that we have taken care of all the prerequisites, we are ready to set up Apache Hadoop. For this, we will go to the official website of Apache Hadoop. Here, we can check out the details of the core components of Apache Hadoop project and a list of other Hadoop related projects at Apache. We will go to releases, where we can check out the details of the various versions of Apache Hadoop. We can download latest stable releases from here, but we want to install Hadoop 1.x. So, we will pick an older but stable release in Hadoop 1.x line. We will install 1.2.1, which got released in August 2013. It is a stable point release for the 1.2 line. Since this is a very old version, we can find it in archives. From here, let us download the Hadoop tar.gz file. After downloading is completed, we can find it in the downloads folder of the Lin user. We can extract it here directly using the graphical user interface. But we will do it using the command line interface. Let us open the terminal and navigate to the downloads directory of the Lin user. We can see the file here. Now, let us unpack it. We have successfully unpacked. We can see the unpacked directory here. Let us move this unpacked directory to a sensible location, such as the /user/local directory where we set up Java. OPT directory in the root is another standard choice. Note that Hadoop should not be installed in a user's home directory, as that may be an NFS mounted directory. So let us navigate to the local directory. And we will create a directory with the name Hadoop here. Now, we will move the unpacked Hadoop directory to this new directory which we created. We also need to change the owner of the Hadoop files to be the HD user and its group. Once we have these things placed in desired locations, let's take a closer look at the Hadoop directory. Hadoop has a set of configuration files in conf directory. Here in conf directory, we can see the configuration files of Hadoop. We need to configure a few things before running Hadoop. That is, we need to either add or modify few parameters in these configuration files to operate Hadoop in whichever mode we want to. Let us start with hadoop-env.sh. We can set Hadoop-specific environment variables here. The only required environment variable is java_home. All others are optional. So, the first thing we need to do is to set environment variable java_home by specifying the location of Java. We already have java_home environment variable set to point to a suitable Java installation. We have done that by adding the variables java_home, jre_home in a shell startup file, /etc/profile file, while installing Java. These variables will be used by default and we don't have to configure anything further. Even so, we can set the Java installation that Hadoop uses by editing hadoop-env.sh in conf directory and specifying the java_home variable. In hadoop-env.sh, we will define the java_home environment variable to point to a Java installation directory. It's a way of telling Hadoop to use a specific Java installation. On our system, we have it defined as to point to the installed version of Java. Now let us set this in the hadoop-env.sh file.
After updating the Java underscore home variable here, leave the line uncommented. Save it. The Hadoop-env.sh file contains other variables for defining our Hadoop environment. But Java underscore home is the only one requiring initial modification. The default settings on the other variables will probably work fine. As we become more familiar with Hadoop, we can later modify this file to suit our individual needs like logging directory location, Java class path, and so on. With this, we have configured Hadoop to use our Java installation. In this sudo distributed mode, all Hadoop daemons run on the same machine but on separate JVMs. Every time we use Hadoop commands, we use Hadoop binaries. And to do that, we will have to use the full path. It will be convenient if we create an environment variable that points to the Hadoop installation directory, Hadoop underscore home by convention, and to put the Hadoop binary directories on our command line path. We can set up the environment variable Hadoop underscore home just like we set up Java underscore home. We will add it in the shell startup file /etc/profile so that it is available on a system level to all the users. Note that bin and sbin directories contains the binaries and scripts for running Hadoop daemons. So they should be included if we plan to run the daemons on our local machine. Save it. Now let us refresh the shell startup file /etc/profile. And now we can check the version of Hadoop that is running with Hadoop version command. The majority of Hadoop settings are contained in XML configuration files. Our Hadoop configuration is driven by two distinct types of configuration files. The default ones, which are read-only. Files here include core-default.xml, hdfs-default.xml, and mapred-default.xml. You can find them in their respective locations. And second, site-specific configuration files. Files here include core-site.xml, hdfs-site.xml, and mapred-site.xml. These site-specific configuration files are found in the conf subdirectory in the Hadoop's home folder. All these files are also known as resources. A resource contains a set of name value pairs as XML data. The default resources, that is the default XML files, which are read-only, reside inside the Hadoop common and Hadoop HDFS jar files. These files, which are read from the jar files directly, should never be modified. Whereas the site-specific resources are loaded from the class path, and their values are used to override the corresponding values in the matching default resource. In simple words, the default resources, that is core-default.xml, hdfs-default.xml, and mapred-default.xml are loaded first, followed by the site-specific resources, which are core-site.xml, hdfs-site.xml and mapred-site.xml. Now let us check up each of these corresponding configuration files. We will start with core-default.xml. We are currently in the Hadoop home directory, which is this. The XML file core-default.xml resides in source core. This is our core-default.xml. Let us open it and check out its contents. As we can see, there are number of properties set in by default. This file contains read-only default values for our Hadoop configuration, and these are the properties that are loaded first. Note that the file can contain any number of these property elements, which are enclosed by one configuration element, as in this example. Each property element defines a specific configuration name-value pair. The description element is optional, but can be quite useful for tracking details about the property it describes. Now, let us check out the corresponding site-specific configuration file, core-site.xml. As we can see, it is empty. There are no properties set in this configuration file. Later in this video, we will add few properties here. Once updated, this file contains site-specific configuration values for our Hadoop deployment and is loaded later, meant to override the properties which are already set in core-default.xml. So this file contains only those values that need to be changed from the default. Similarly, the other two site-specific configuration files, hdfs-site.xml and mapred-site.xml, are also empty. As we can see, hdfs-site.xml is also empty. We can put site-specific property overrides in this file. Now let us check mapred-site.xml. As expected, this is also empty. These files are located in the conf subdirectory. Before version 0.20, these XML configuration files were hadoop-default.xml and hadoop-site.xml. As the names imply, hadoop-default.xml contains the default Hadoop settings to be used unless they are explicitly overridden in hadoop-site.xml. In version 0.20, this hadoop-site.xml file has been separated out into three XML files: core-site.xml, hdfs-site.xml, and mapred-site.xml. This refactoring better aligns the configuration settings to the subsystem of Hadoop that they control. That is, now each component in Hadoop is configured using an XML file. For example, common properties go in core-site.xml. And properties pertaining to HDFS go into hdfs-site.xml. MapReduce properties into mapred-site.xml. By configuring these XML files accordingly, Hadoop can be run in one of the three modes: standalone mode, pseudo distributed mode, or in a fully distributed mode. To run Hadoop in a particular mode, we need to do two things. First, set the appropriate properties in their respective configuration files and then start the Hadoop daemons. We have already checked the content of these files and they are empty. That is, no properties are set in them yet. With such empty configuration files, Hadoop runs in the standalone mode. The standalone mode is the default mode for Hadoop. When we first uncompress the Hadoop source package, it is ignorant of our hardware setup. That is, Hadoop doesn't know whether we are trying to run it on a single node or on multiple nodes. Hence, Hadoop chooses to be conservative and assumes a minimal configuration. In standalone mode, there is no further action to take since the default properties are set for standalone mode and there are no daemons to run. All the three XML configuration files, core-site.xml, hdfs-site.xml, and mapred-site.xml are empty under this default mode. In standalone mode, the local file system and the local MapReduce job runner are used. Hence, this mode is also called as local mode. With empty configuration files, Hadoop will run completely on the local machine. Because there is no need to communicate with other nodes, the standalone mode does not use HDFS, nor will it launch any of the Hadoop daemons. Its primary use is for developing and debugging the application logic of a MapReduce program without the additional complexity of interacting with the daemons. We will cover the various Hadoop commands in the due course of this tutorial. But for our current purpose, we only need to know that the command to run a Hadoop MapReduce program that is written in Java is Hadoop space jar space name of the jar file. As the command implies, Hadoop MapReduce programs written in Java are packaged in jar files for execution, that is, Java archive files. The default installation already has several sample MapReduce programs that we can use. Let us see what is available in the examples jar file. We will see about a dozen example MapReduce programs prepackaged with Hadoop, and one of them is a popular word counting program called WordCount. For now, we will only follow the mechanics of executing a Hadoop MapReduce program. Later in the course, we will see how to develop our own MapReduce programs from scratch. Now, let us see how WordCount program works in the standalone mode. Executing WordCount program without specifying any arguments will show its usage information. In the usage information, we can see the arguments list. The only mandatory parameters are an input directory of text documents we want to analyze and an output directory where the program will dump its output. To execute WordCount program, we need to first create an input directory in our local file system and put some text documents in it. We can add any text document to the directory. For instance, let us create a directory named input in the home directory of HDUser. Now, we need few text files in this directory. We have a sample text file called input.txt on our desktop. This has some text in it. We will copy this text file into our input directory. And note that we can have multiple text files as well.
we have copied input.txt file in our desired location. We will now analyze its word counts and see the results. That is, we will run word count MapReduce program on this input directory. We can see the MapReduce program running. And notice that it is run by the local job runner. Now, let us check the output. We can also see a flag which signifies the success of the program. Here, parter file is the output file. We can see a word count of every word used in the document listed in alphabetical order. By looking at this output, we can notice a number of shortcomings in the included word count program. Tokenization is based purely on whitespace characters and not punctuation marks, making Hadoop and Hadoop underscore separate words. The same is true for capitalization, where Hadoop with capital H and Hadoop with small h appear as separate words. Fortunately, the source code of word count program is available and included in the installation at Here, we can find the source code, that is .java files. We can take a copy of this wordcount.java file and we can use text editors or IDEs like Eclipse or NetBeans to modify it as per our requirements. This is the command we used to run our wordcount MapReduce program. Hadoop-examples.jar is the jar file that contains the .class file of wordcount program. WordCount is the name of the driver class of the program. And input is the local directory which we created and copied a text file input.txt into it. Output is the local directory created by the program automatically to store the output files. So, the input is taken from a local directory, the MapReduce job is run by a local job runner, and output is placed in a local directory. There is no question of distributed storage and distributed processing in this mode. Now, we will configure Hadoop to run in a pseudo-distributed mode. As discussed earlier, pseudo-distributed mode means running Hadoop on a single node cluster. All the distributed components of Hadoop come into play. That is, all the Hadoop daemons that are responsible for distributed storage and distributed processing will run on the same machine. The master daemons, name node, job tracker, secondary name node, along with the slave processes, the data node and task tracker, all run on the same machine but on separate JVMs. This mode complements the standalone mode for debugging our code, allowing us to examine memory usage, HDFS input-output issues, and other daemon interactions. Now, we need to configure three separate XML files, all found in the conf directory, core-site.xml,
hdfs-site.xml and mapred-site.xml. First, let us start with core-site.xml. In core-site.xml, we need to set a property whose name is fs.default.name. Before we do that, let us check out the default value set for this property in core-default.xml. In this file, let us search for the property fs.default.name. Here it is. Here the value set is file colon followed by 3 slashes, which is actually a URI and it indicates the local file system. This is the default value we get with Hadoop installation. So, in this default mode, which is standalone mode, input data is taken from the local file system and output data is also placed in the local file system. Hence, this standalone mode is also called as local mode. While setting up Hadoop in sudo distributed mode, we would want to override this by setting a different value for this property in core-site.xml. Let us copy this property and get back to the file core-site.xml. As we already know, there are no properties set in this file. Let us copy our property and we'll update this value. In here, we need to provide the name of the file system we would like to use, which is HDFS. The value to this property is set in the form of a URI. A URI whose scheme and authority determine the file system implementation. A URI mainly composes of two parts, scheme and authority. In our case, the scheme is HDFS. HDFS here is the file system implementation class of Hadoop distributed file system. And the authority composes of hostname on which namenode process is running, colon, port number of the namenode process. The URI's authority is used to determine the host, port number, etc. for a file system. We will save this and move on to configure the next configuration file, which is hdfs-site.xml. In hdfs-site.xml, we need to set a property whose name is dfs.replication. This property determines the replication factor on a cluster level. We will learn more about it when we discuss about HDFS. But to put in simple words, replication factor determines how many copies of each dataset has to be maintained. First, let us check out the default value set for this property in hdfs-default.xml. If we try to find the property in this file, we will notice that it is not available. So let's move on to update the hdfs-site.xml with this property. We will update this file with the property dfs.replication. We have set the value to 1. We have set it to 1 as we are running Hadoop only on one node.
Save it.
Next configuration file is mapred-site.xml. In mapred-site.xml, we need to set a property whose name is mapred.job.tracker. If we check out the default value set for this property in mapred-default.xml, we will notice that it is not available. So let's just update the mapred-site.xml with this property. The value is the host name on which job tracker process is running, colon, and its port number.
Save it.
Finally, we must specify the host name of the node on which the secondary name node is running in the masters file. In our case, as we have only one node, secondary name node will also run on the local host. We can see the master's file is already updated. And we must also specify the host names of the slave nodes in the slaves file. In our case, there is only one node, that is localhost. And even slaves file is also updated. With this, we are almost ready to start Hadoop. But first, we will need to format our HDFS. Before HDFS can be used for the first time, the file system must be formatted. The formatting process creates an empty file system by creating the storage directories and the initial versions of the name nodes persistent data structures. Data nodes are not involved in the initial formatting process, since the name node is the one which manages all of the file system's metadata, and data nodes can join or leave the cluster dynamically. For the same reason, we don't need to say how large a file system to create, since this is determined by the number of data nodes in the cluster, which can be increased as needed even after the file system is formatted. It's done. Hadoop comes with scripts for running commands and starting and stopping Hadoop daemons across the whole cluster. These scripts can be found in bin and sbin directories. To use these scripts, we need to tell Hadoop which machines are in the cluster. There is a file for this purpose called slaves. It contains a list of the machine host names or IP addresses, one per line. The slaves file has a list of host names on which the data nodes and task trackers should run on. We can launch the Hadoop daemons by use of the script start-all.sh. The Java JPS command will list all daemons that are running to verify if the setup was successful. So here we can see a list of processes that are running. With this, we are done setting up single node Hadoop cluster. We can start working on it. Later, when we are finished with Hadoop, we can shut down the Hadoop daemons by using another shell script called stopall.sh. This stops all the Hadoop daemons. Now again, if we use Java JPS command, we can see no Hadoop daemons are running. There are many ways in which we can monitor our Hadoop cluster. System monitoring is critical for maintaining the health and availability for large distributed systems such as Hadoop. General monitoring tasks include monitoring the health of cluster nodes and networks. For example, the usage of memory, heap, CPU, network, and so on. For a Hadoop cluster, we may also monitor some specific metrics such as the status of jobs and tasks in the cluster, the status of the job tracker, task trackers, name node, and data nodes. Hadoop comes with many commands out of the box, which help us in keeping our Hadoop cluster running smoothly and at a high level of performance. Let us start our Hadoop daemons first. JPS to confirm. So we can see name node, job tracker, task tracker, data node, and secondary name node are running. Next, Hadoop comes with many commands out of the box, which help us in keeping our Hadoop cluster running smoothly and at a high level of performance. Like for example, we have Hadoop DFS admin hyphen report command, which reports the basic file system information and statistics. And another way to monitor our Hadoop cluster is through web user interfaces. Now that we have gone through all the settings to successfully get a Hadoop cluster up and running, we will talk about the web user interfaces that provide for basic monitoring of the cluster's state. Having covered the operational modes of Hadoop, we can now discuss about the web interfaces that Hadoop provides to monitor the health of our cluster. The name node hosts a general report on port 50070. So the URL would be localhost : 50070. This gives us an overview of the state of our cluster's HDFS. From this interface, we can browse through the file system. We can check the status of each data node in our cluster. And also, we can check out the Hadoop daemon logs to verify if our cluster is functioning correctly. The browser interface allows us to access information we desire much faster than digging through logs and directories manually. Let us explore this interface a little bit more. On browsing the file system, we can notice there is only one directory under root, which is temp. In temp directory, we have a subdirectory Hadoop-HDUser and so on. Now, let's create a directory called HDUser in the root, and we will create a subdirectory called input in HDUser. We will then verify it using the web interface. When we just type Hadoop and press enter, it displays many details and the options that can be used. Amongst these options, we will be using FS to run a generic file system user client. So, Hadoop FS-mkdir-p root and the subdirectory. First, let us verify it using the command line interface. Hadoop fs-ls root. Under root directory, we can see the directory HDUser that we created. In the directory HDUser, we have created another subdirectory called input. Now let us verify the same using the web interface. On browsing the file system, under root, we can notice the directory we created, HDUser. We can see our directory input. Now let us copy the file input.txt that we used in our word count MapReduce program into this input directory. The file input.txt is located in our local file system at this is our file input.txt, which we want to copy into our HDFS. Hadoop fs copy from local path of the source directory
the file name and the path of the target directory, which is root hd user input . This command copies a file from local file system to Hadoop distributed file system. Let us verify it. So, we successfully copied the file input.txt from our local file system to HDFS. Now let us check it out using the web interface. This is the file which we copied. And this is the content of the file. There is another interface that Hadoop provides. Hadoop provides a similar status overview of MapReduce jobs. It is hosted at port 50030 of the node on which job tracker is running. HTTP localhost :50030. Again, a wealth of information is available through this reporting interface. We can access the status of ongoing MapReduce tasks as well as detailed reports about completed jobs. The latter is of particular importance. These logs describe which nodes performed which tasks and the time or resources required to complete each task. Finally, the Hadoop configuration for each job is also available. With all this information, we can streamline our MapReduce programs to better utilize the resources of our cluster. Now that we have our single node Hadoop cluster set up, we will run a MapReduce job and see how it works in pseudo distributed mode. This is the examples jar file, which has come prepackaged along with the Hadoop installation, and this contains the word count program as well. Hadoop jar and the jar file name. Here is the word count MapReduce program that counts the words in the input files. Now we will run the word count MapReduce program against our input file, which is input.txt. That we copied into HDFS. The jar file name, the driver class name of the word count MapReduce program. Well, if we notice, the command looks pretty much the same, except only this time the input directory is the HDFS directory. In root, we have HD user input. We are asking it to take all the files from the input directory, and also the output directory is in HDFS. We have not created this output directory in HDFS, but on running the job, Hadoop will create it for us. We can see the MapReduce job running. Let us check it out in the interface. So here we can see a running MapReduce task. The map phase is completed and the reduce phase is in the process. This is the job ID which is created for our MapReduce job. The job has successfully completed. We can see both the map phase and reduce phase complete. On clicking the job ID, we can see all the details related to that job. The details include on which nodes the MapReduce job has run, along with the time and resources that were required. Now let us check out the output directory
using the NameNode web interface. On browsing the file system, HD user, we can see the output directory which is created by Hadoop when we ran the job. In output, we can see the output file. And this is the output. Though the usefulness of these tools may not be immediately apparent at this stage, but they will come in handy as we begin to perform more sophisticated tasks on our cluster. We will realize their importance as we study Hadoop more in depth. Both standalone and pseudo distributed modes are meant for development and debugging purposes. An actual Hadoop cluster runs in the third mode, the fully distributed mode. With this knowledge, we will be able to begin writing our own MapReduce applications and realize the true potential that Hadoop has to offer. And finally, we want to hear from you. As the viewer of this tutorial, you are our most important critic and commentator. We value your opinion and want to know what we are doing right, what we could do better, and any other words of wisdom you are willing to pass our way. We welcome your comments. Your feedback will be enormously helpful in improvising the final shape of this course. So please subscribe to the DataRaj channel and contribute any questions, comments, or suggestions in the comment section below. Thank you.